Good morning, dear students. I am Dr. Shabana here, assistant professor from the Department of Anatomy. A warm welcome to Government Medical College, Siddipet. My hearty congratulations to you all. And of course, congratulate your parents as well. Like it's a combined effort of you and your parents. God bless you all. Now let us discuss now. We have already started with general anatomy. So in this general anatomy, you have finished various topics, and the topic which I would be discussing today is lymphatic system. So we must be knowing something about lymphatic system, like it's the system which is actually helping to collect the lymph and send it back to the venous system. Now let us see under what headings we are going to discuss this topic. The objectives of today's lecture are, we will see the introduction, we will see components of lymphatic system, we will see what is lymph, what are lymph capillaries, what is the difference between lymph capillaries, lymph vessels, what are the various lymphoid organs, lymph nodes, spleen, thymus. We will also study few points about epithelio-lymphoid system. Now coming to the introduction part, lymphatic system is essentially a drainage system which is accessory to venous system. That means it is actually helping the venous system. Let us see how does it help. Now see here, we know heart is pumping the oxygenated blood to the tissues. Okay, because you have finished the cardiovascular system, there you should have come across, like from the aorta, we have arteries, arterioles, meta-arterioles and capillaries. Okay, so the capillaries are thin walled vessels which are actually allowing the blood components to diffuse across the tissue, isn't it? The glucose diffuses, oxygen diffuses, whatever is required is generally diffusing through capillaries. So these capillaries will have two ends. One is the arterial end, the other is venous end. So whatever is like the end products of the tissue metabolisms, like carbon dioxide and lactic acid, the end products, they are all collected by the venous end of the capillaries, and then it is going to venules, veins. Finally, it will be going back to superior and inferior vena cava to enter into the right atrium of heart. So basically, arterial system is supplying the nutrients, venous system is collecting the end products, bringing back it to heart for further filtration. Now, what is this lymphatic system then? See, suppose these background cells you are finding, these are tissue cells, and in between you have tissue spaces. So whatever things, fluid and the constituents which are not collected by the venous end of capillaries will now be collected by this violet colored structures which are shown for our understanding. Those are the lymphatic capillaries. That's how you use this word. Lymphatic system is essentially a drainage system which is supporting the venous system. That means the lymphatic capillaries will collect the left out fluid, that is usually called as lymph, from the tissue spaces, and then it is bringing back. And as you can see, the lymphatic system is also draining into venous system. Okay, let us be very much clear with this point. So most of the tissue fluid formed at the arterial end of capillaries is absorbed back into blood by venous end of capillaries. Rest, which is not absorbed by the venous end of the capillaries, is now absorbed by lymphatics, which begin as blindly in tissue spaces, and they collect this fluid which is left over in the tissue spaces, and it is coming back to the venous system, thereby to the right atrium of the heart. Now coming to the components of lymphatic system. So lymphatic system has lymph capillaries, lymph vessels, okay, lymphoid organs, lymph nodes, spleen and thymus. And of course, we also have epithelial lymphoid system. Now let us see, in this picture, if you observe, we have all these structures we are shown in light green in color. Those are all lymph vessels, okay? The lymph vessels will be collecting the lymph, okay? And finally, actually throughout these lymph vessels, here and there, we will find lymph nodes. Area-wise, the name differs. This area is inguinal area. We call it as inguinal group of lymph nodes. Okay, this area below the arm, and between the thoracic cage, this area is actually axilla. So in the axilla region, the lymph nodes are called as axillary group of lymph nodes. So in the neck region, they are called as cervical group of lymph nodes. Okay, apart from these, that means area wise, the name will differ. We will discuss in detail about lymphatic drainage when we discuss about each organ, each structure of our body. This is only a general anatomy for a general idea. Now, see here, apart from these lymph nodes, if you observe in this picture, we also have lymph organs, like you are shown spleen here. Okay, so in the chest region, like in the like you will come across the word like mediastinum, in the superior mediastinal region behind the sternum bone, in the upper part you will also see one more lymphoid organ which is called as thymus. Okay, then so you have seen lymph nodes, now you have seen spleen, now thymus also I will show you as we proceed. Okay, epithelial lymphoid system also we will discuss in detail. Okay, and bone marrow is also one of the components of lymphatic system. Now, let us describe lymph first. Number one is lymph. So, let us see what is lymph. See, the background tissue, whatever you are finding is actually tissue cells. Okay, in between we have the intercellular components. Okay, we already know like this is artery and this is capillary, which is the arterial end. The bluish violetish area is the venous end of the capillary, and these green lines which are starting like blind capillaries, these are nothing but lymph capillaries. And the tissue fluid which is left over, which is not collected by the venous end of the capillaries, is now called as lymph, which will be collected by lymph capillaries. Now let us see, the tissue fluid that enters the lymph capillaries is called lymph. Okay, I told you the fluid which is present in the tissues, which is not collected by the venous end of the capillaries, is now collected by its assistant. Okay, just to make you understand, I'm using this term. Okay, so that is lymph capillaries are collecting the tissue fluid, which is called as lymph. When you just look at the lymph, it is clear watery fluid, similar in composition to plasma. Exception is we do not have plasma proteins. Because it is whitish in color, clear water, it is clearly understood that it doesn't even have RBCs, no red blood cells. So lymph from the small intestine, which is collected, suppose this background tissue, if you consider it as the cells of small intestine, the lymph which is collected from the small intestine will be milky white in color, which is called as chyle, which is nothing but large droplets of fat is also observed from the intestine, giving that particular whitish appearance, milky whitish appearance. Again, you are shown like in different slides, like arterial end of the capillaries, venous end of the capillaries. The work which is undone by the venous end of the capillaries is now started doing work by the lymphatic capillary. So like the lymph is like transports plasma proteins that seep out of capillary beds back to bloodstream. So lymph contains, that means in this lymphatic capillaries, the fluid what is present, it is actually containing lymphocytes, macromolecules of protein, it contains fat droplets, just now I told you the GAT, intestinal chyle, dust particles it contains, carbon particles, and also bacteria, etc. Now suppose, what is lymph edema? Now see here, about 30 liters of fluid is passing from arterial end of capillaries into intercellular space every day. 27 liters of it is being absorbed back into the heart by venous end of capillaries. 3 liters consisting of macromolecules of protein, fat droplets and particulate matter such as bacteria is absorbed by lymph capillaries. Okay. So that means venous system, drainage system of fine type, lymphatic system, drainage system of coarse type. Coarse type in the sense large size macromolecules are also being collected by lymphatic system and it is being sent back to venous system. So suppose that means lymphatic system is how much work it is doing, how many liters of fluid it is transporting to heart via venous system? 3 liters. In case if there is any blockage in this lymphatic system, and suppose if this lymph is not being transported by the lymphatic system back to heart, This 3 liters of fluid, which is not drained by the lymphatic system, it starts accumulating in the tissue fluid, which may lead to edema, that is swelling. You should have seen among your relatives or among your like patients, like there will be some people who will be suffering with enlargement of body organs, that is nothing but edema. Okay. Now you can see this is one picture I kept to make you understand. So this is edema. Generalized body edema is actually called as anasarca. You should have also studied in your intermediate about filariasis, Wuchereria, Bancrofti, like parasitic infection or infestation, where you will see large amount of tissue fluid, it becomes hardened, this form of mass. Okay, like this elephantiasis is one example which you can quote for accumulation of tissue fluid. Okay, that is edema. So we know this green capillaries are lymph capillaries. These are microscopic blind end lymph vessels which begin in intercellular spaces. Now if you observe this lymph capillaries, now see this is one lymph capillary, this is one more, all are lymph capillaries. Now they are lined with endothelial cells and they will have large gaps. In fact, when you compare with the venous end of the capillaries, the lymphatic end of the capillaries will have large openings so as to allow large molecules to enter into the lymph capillaries, so that large molecules can come back and they can be drained to heart. Okay, so walls are made up of single layer of endothelial cells. As you can see here, this is only one layer of endothelial cells. When you just compare with the previous class where you have studied the microscopic structure of artery and vein, there you have found tunica intima, media and adventitia. That means the wall of those blood vessels are quite thick. But when you see here, the wall of lymphatic vessel is made up of only a single layer of cells, that is endothelial cells. Okay. So most numerous in skin, we find in glands, mucus and serous membranes, we find these lymph capillaries. So lymph capillaries within the villi of small intestines, they are given a special name. They are called as lacteals. They absorb fat and transport it into the blood circulation. I told you the fat which is absorbed in the small intestine is called as chyle, which is milky white. Now if you observe the difference between lymph capillaries and blood capillaries, so the lymph capillaries, they are beginning as blind blind vessels, which are actually starting in tissue spaces, that is intercellular spaces. Okay, these are blind vessels. Okay, then they have bigger lumen, they are less regular also. Okay, just now let us do a comparative study. This is an artery, arterial end. You see tunica intima, media and adventitia. This is vein, which is highly collapsible because media will contain less number of smooth muscles. And this is lymphatic capillary. Lymphatic capillary is made up of only one layer of endothelial cells. Okay, so which is thinner now? When you compare, the most thinnest of all among all these three is lymphatic capillary. Okay. Now these lymphatic capillaries are permeable to bigger molecules, hence they can absorb tissue fluid containing large sized molecules, particulate matter and also colloid material. Now let us see where are the sites where lymph capillaries are absent. They are absent in epidermis. Let us see the pictures also simultaneously, then I will read out. They are absent in epidermis. Okay, they are absent in hair, nails, they are absent in cornea. Okay, they are absent in this cartilage which is lining the bone, that is articular cartilage. They are absent in brain and spinal cord. Okay, we even do not find lymph capillaries in the bone marrow and also in the splenic pulp. Now, after this lymph capillaries, now let us know what are lymph vessels. So, for which better you see, these are the tissue cells. In between, we have tissue space from where the fluid was collected by these blind capillary vessels. Okay, so these are lymph capillaries which are single lined by single endothelial lining. So the lymph, which is traveling from the lymph capillaries, it is now traveling to a little wider vessel. This little wide, the diameter is little increasing now. When you see the diameter is smaller, now this has become little bigger, you call it as lymph vessels. So when the lymph is moving from the lymph capillaries to lymph vessels, you can see the lymph nodes have started. P size, P. Okay, this is P-sized areas, like P-shaped structures, not P-sized, but P-shaped structures you are finding, these are nothing but lymph nodes. Okay, that means as you proceed, the system has actually started with lymph capillaries, then lymphatic vessels. Okay, the lymph vessels will join still wider, like diameter vessel you are finding, that is called as lymph duct. The largest lymphatic duct I will show you now, that is the thoracic duct. Finally, as I have been telling you, the lymph is finally draining into the veins. That means lymphatic system is acting as assistant to the venous system. So smaller lymph vessels, they merge to form progressively larger lymph vessels. These larger lymph vessels further they drain into lymph ducts, which finally drain into vein, which is the left subclavian vein, especially thoracic duct. Now see here, the whole cardiovascular system is shown along with this. See, this is the tissue spaces where you are finding the green lines are nothing but lymphatic capillaries. We have lymph nodes. Okay, so we have lymph vessels. From here, the lymph is transported finally to the lymph duct. The lymph duct is connected to venous system. That means the lymph is also reaching the heart. Okay. Now, how does the lymph vessel look? The lymph vessel is also lined with the endothelial cells, and inside you are finding valves. Like you have seen in the veins also, in the cardiovascular system class, inside the veins you have valves. And we know these valves are responsible for unidirectional flow of blood. Similarly, here, the valves are also like allowing the lymph to travel only in one direction, that is towards the heart. Okay, the unidirectional flow of lymph is regulated because of the presence of valves. And when you compare with veins and the lymph capillaries, lymph vessels, the lymph vessels will have large number of valves compared to veins. Why? Because they are very much thin walled structures and the lymph has to move against gravity. That's the reason we have large number of valves inside. And when you observe these lymph vessels, they will be beaded, beads. They will appear as though they are beaded because of the presence of valves, large number of valves inside. Okay. So it has beaded appearance due to the presence of numerous valves within their lumen. This beaded appearance of lymphatic vessel. The flow of lymph is unidirectional towards large veins. Okay, now let us see. We have superficial lymph vessels and deep lymph vessels, based on which we usually classify the lymphatic drainage also as superficial group of lymph nodes and deep group of lymph nodes. Now let us see what is the difference. Superficial lymphatic vessels, they are found in superficial fascia deep to the skin. They join deep lymphatic vessels. Now, where do we find deep lymphatic vessels? They are found deep to deep fascia. Okay, when you come to dissection hall, when you do dissection, you will actually appreciate these structures. Just below the skin, whatever fascia we see covering the muscles, you will be, that will be the superficial fascia. Distributed along the superficial fascia will be superficial lymph vessels. And as we go deeper into the deeper plane, deep muscles we will have, covering them will be the deep fascia, and along with them, whatever lymph vessels we have, those are the deep lymph vessels. Okay, so lymph vessels are supplied by vasa vasorum and are accompanied by a plexus of fine blood vessels. I hope you remember vasa vasorum are nothing but the blood vessels to large blood vessels like aorta. Okay, now let us see what are the factors which are responsible for drainage of this lymph. We know that lymph has to make a quite long journey. For example, if you start from the tip of these fingers, It has to travel from palm, forearm, arm, axilla, thorax, and finally the lymph should reach the heart. Similarly, if you start from lower limb, abdomen, it has to cross thorax, and finally the lymph has to reach the venous system. So that means quite long journey the lymph has to take so as to travel to the heart. Okay, now what are the various factors we have? So contraction of smooth muscle in the wall of lymph vessels, pulsation of arteries which are very close to these lymphatic vessels, then massaging action of the muscles which are actually present along with this superficial and deep lymphatics, filtration pressure in the tissue spaces generated by filtration of fluid from blood capillaries, respiratory movements produced by the diaphragm and intercostal muscles, negative pressure in the brachiocephalic veins, valves within the lumen of lymph vessels which will allow the unidirectional flow of lymph. All these will allow the lymph to go back to heart. Okay, now let us see this clinical condition which is called as lymphangitis. So lymphangitis is nothing but inflammation of lymph vessels. Itis, always itis word indicates inflammation, ang word indicates blood vessel. Okay, any vessel in fact. So if lymph vessel is inflamed, you call it as lymphangitis. Okay, you can see this picture which is showing as an example where you have the inflammation of lymphatic vessel. It appears like a pinkish reddish streak in the skin extending from the site of infection to the group of lymph nodes where the lymph vessel is draining itself. Elephantiasis, it's a condition like Wuchereria bancrofti, parasitic infestation. So lymph vessels draining the lower limb are blocked by slender worms of filaria. Accumulation of fluid in the interstitial spaces of this limb, scrotum, anywhere it can affect. So, and lymph vessels may cause permanent swelling and enlargement of lower limb, resembling elephant's leg. That's why it's called as elephantiasis. We know the lymph ducts. I told you whole of the lymph is now getting transported to the largest lymphatic duct. The largest lymphatic duct of our body is called thoracic duct. The details of thoracic duct, we will be taking it separately also when we go with regional anatomy thorax. Okay, because it is general anatomy, we will give you all general information. We may not go into more details because more detailed lecture is there for thoracic duct. So when you talk about thoracic duct, it is the largest lymphatic duct measuring about 45 centimeters. From outside only, if you observe, it is showing beaded appearance. And I hope you remember now the beaded appearance is due to the presence of valves inside. Okay, for the unidirectional flow of lymph. Okay, then it begins as a large sac. As you can see here, this is this large elongated sac of this thoracic duct is actually called as cisterna chyli. Okay, which is so the thoracic duct is the largest lymphatic duct measuring 45 centimeters. It starts as cisterna chyli lying in front of the vertebral bodies L1 and L2. Okay, these are lumbar vertebrae L1 and L2, right in front of which we will find cisterna chyli. Okay, then. So it ends, now if you observe this thoracic duct, where is it ending? So it is ending between two veins, which is, this is left internal jugular vein and this is left subclavian vein. This is just making an angle, turning behind the left internal jugular vein and opening at the junction of these two. Okay? Then. So now, the area which is drained by this thoracic duct, two lower limbs, the external genitalia region, inguinal region, whole of the abdomen, okay, the left upper limb, left part of the thorax, left upper half of the head and neck region is drained by thoracic duct. Same thing is written here. Okay, Rest, whatever is left over, is drained by another duct, which is called as right lymphatic duct. Okay. So now this was our thoracic duct. Now let us see, there is one more duct traveling. You call it as right lymphatic duct, which is seen on the right side. So it is dilated lymphatic vessel about 1 centimeter long. Okay, it lies in the root of the neck on the right side. It is formed by the union of 3 vessels. Okay, that is right subclavian trunk, right subclavian trunk is this, right jugular trunk is this, and right bronchomediastinal trunk. 3 of them have joined to form this right lymphatic duct. It ends where? By opening in the angle between right internal jugular vein and right subclavian vein. Okay, this area is completely drained by right lymphatic duct. Okay, then now we have lymphoid organs. So made up of lymphatic tissue. So lymphatic tissue, specialized connective tissue, and consists of framework of reticular fibers and reticular cells, lymphocytes mainly, plasma cells and macrophages. Circumscribed concentration of lymphatic tissue, that is lymph nodules. So now if you see histologically, you will have a separate subject also in anatomy, that is histology, where you make use of hematoxylin and eosin dyes in order to see the slides under the microscope, and these slides have been prepared from our various body tissues. So this slide has been prepared from lymph nodule, where you are from the lymph node, where inside you are finding the lymphatic nodule. Okay, before I take you to this lymphatic nodule, I'll come back to this lymphatic nodule. See here, this is one lymph node. Outside covering of this lymph node is capsule. Inside the lymph node, you are finding the collection of dark blue areas. In center, we have light purple areas. These are nothing but lymphatic nodules. Like that, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all these are lymphatic nodules. When you look under the microscope, the lymphatic nodules will have peripheral darker lymphocytes and pale central area. This pale central area is actually called as germinal center, where the maturation process of lymphocytes is taking place. As the lymphocytes mature, they come towards periphery and they are seen as dark lymphocytes. Okay, so that's what I was telling you. Light stained areas in the center, these are called as germinal center. They are surrounded by darkly stained zone of densely packed small lymphocytes, which are mature lymphocytes. So germinal center, I told you, it is all the area factory where the lymphocytes are being produced. So the factory where the lymphocytes, they are actually found in the form of blast cells. Okay, proliferating cells, multiplying cells are called as blast cells. So they are lymphoblasts, plasmoblasts, which produce lymphocytes and plasma cells, which will be moving towards periphery. Okay, develops only when the nodule is exposed to some particular antigen. These are absent in embryonic life and in old age, the germinal centers. Now the types of lymphoid organs, we have primary lymphoid organs like involved in the production of lymphocytes. We have bone marrow, we have thymus. Okay, secondary lymphoid organs involved in the activation of lymphocytes and initiation of immune response. Those are nothing but P-shaped organs, those are lymph nodes, and we have seen spleen also. Now, these are the lymph nodes. This exclusively one lymph node has been shown, which is ovalar bean-shaped bodies and size is 0.1 to 2.5 centimeters long. The lymph is passing through number of lymph nodes, usually 8 to 10 lymph nodes, before they reach large lymphatic ducts like thoracic duct or right lymphatic duct. So lymph nodes, they appear pink in the living body and brownish in cadaver. I have kept one slide to show you one lymph node. When you come to dissection hall, when we do dissection, we come across the structures like this, which are lymph nodes. Okay, these are all lymphatic vessels. So the bluish thing, what you are finding is the blood vessel. Underlying structure is muscle. Okay. So we have various lymph nodes based on the area where they are present, they are named differently. So area in the knee joint area, behind knee joint, we call it as popliteal fossa. There you use the word popliteal lymph nodes. This groins area, you call it as inguinal group of lymph nodes. We know we have aorta here. Along the distribution of iota, we call them as aortic group of lymph nodes. Aorta will divide into right and left common iliacs, no? And then which further divides into external and internal iliacs. So the lymph nodes distributed along them, you call them as external and internal group of lymph nodes. Okay, in the axillary region, you call it as axillary group of lymph nodes. In the elbow region, it is epitrochlear lymph nodes. In the neck region, they are cervical group of lymph nodes. In the occipital region, they are occipital group of lymph nodes. In the ear region, we call them as auricular group of lymph nodes. If they are present in front, you call it as anterior auricular. If it is behind, you call it as posterior auricular. Okay. So in the mandible region, below mandible, we call it as submandibular, and below maxilla, you call it as submaxillary group of lymph nodes. So all names based on the area where they are present. Cervical in the neck region, axillary in the armpit, mediastinal region is this, aortic is this one, okay, iliac is this one, popliteal already I told you, these are inguinal group, okay, superficial lymph nodes, they are present in the superficial fascia and are arranged along veins. So deep lymph nodes, they are present along, I already told you this point also, deep to the deep fascia, and they are arranged along the arteries. Okay, so superficial nodes drain into deep lymph nodes. Now let us see the structure of lymph node. Before I keep any text, let us try to understand. This P-shaped organ is nothing but lymph node. So the lymph node will receive the lymph via afferent lymphatics. The afferent lymphatics will bring the lymph. The lymph will enter into this lymph node. Inside the lymph node, we have lymphatic nodules, which are the areas of filtration. That means the lymphocytes, mature lymphocytes which are present here, will kill the bacteria. Such filtered lymph will now enter into efferent lymphatic vessel. Further, it moves to next lymph node, higher lymph nodes. That's how filtration process goes on at least 5 to 10 times before it reaches the heart via the venous channel. Okay. Now, structure of lymph node, it is present as a slight depression on one side. You have this area which is called as hilum. Many afferent lymphatic vessels, 1, 2, 3, 4 have been shown to enter the gland at the periphery. Okay, and leaving the gland, you are finding one efferent lymphatic vessel. Okay, at the hilum. At the hilum, you are also finding one artery and vein also. Artery enters and vein leaves the lymph node at the hilum. Each lymph node consists of this outermost covering, which is called as fibrous capsule, okay, and the glandular substance inside. This is all parenchyma inside. Okay, to take more details, now see here, this is the reverse side of the lymph node, what we have seen in the previous slide. See, this green line is capsule. These are all afferent lymphatic vessels bringing the lymph. Okay, just below the capsule, the area is subcapsular sinus. Okay, and these are all lymphatic nodules which are shown in violet color. Okay, so this area is basically cortex. Okay, just below the cortex area, we have paracortex area. And this light green area, whatever has been shown, is medullary area. Okay, the lymph is entering through afferent lymphatic vessels. It's being filtered. Okay, and it is passing through paracortical area, and then it is entering into the medulla area, where we have these medullary cords, okay, medullary sinuses. Okay, medullary sinuses will carry the lymph finally into efferent lymphatic vessel. That's how the lymph has to travel outside. Now let us see. Capsule, this green lining is capsule, which is investing entire lymph node, and it is separated from the substance by this area, which is subcapsular sinus. Okay. Then number of trabeculae. Trabeculae means partitions. You are finding these are the partitions extend from the capsule at variable distances into the substance of the gland. Then afferent lymphatic vessels, they pierce the capsule and drain into subcapsular sinus. Okay. From subcapsular sinus, the lymph drains via series of interconnected channels from the cortex into the medullary sinuses. Okay, finally it will be moving towards the hilum, where we have single efferent lymphatic vessel from where the lymph has to travel outside. Okay, now see this cortex area, the outer portion, it is containing B lymphocytes, Okay, these are all lymphatic follicles. Okay, so lymphatic follicles without germinal center, they are actually called as primary nodules, and with germinal centers, they are called as secondary nodules. Inner portion, this pink area, which is paracortex, it contains T lymphocytes. This is thymus dependent zone. Thymus is one more lymphatic organ, thymic dependent zone. So T lymphocytes do not form lymphoid nodules. Please remember, in the lymphoid nodules, we have only B lymphocytes, B for Bombay, okay, Bhubaneswar. Only B lymphocytes in the lymphoid nodules. Okay, this is the medullary region, which is containing medullary cords, which have B lymphocytes, plasma cells, and macrophages. Okay, this green area. Now, this is the histology picture. Lymphatic system, we will also teach you when we start histology for you. Again, all these points will be repeated. Even if you don't understand any point, and if you find it lengthy also, don't worry. Again, this thing will be repeated in histology. This is the histology slide, in fact, which is showing you the capsule of lymph node, subcapsular area, trabeculae, pink strands. In between, you have all these are lymphatic nodules. So in lymphatic nodules, peripheral darker lymphocytes, mature ones, and central paler area is germinal center, where maturation process, lymphoblasts, plasma blasts are present. Okay, as you come here, you have medullary cords and medullary sinuses. Now the functions of lymph nodes, I already told you, they filter the lymph, isn't it? They evoke immunological response, they produce various types of lymphocytes, okay? So the germinal centers is the factory of production, I told you, B lymphocytes are produced, okay? So they provide portal of entry for lymphocytes into lymphatic channels. So in the initial slides, I have shown you the lymphatic vessel is made up of only one endothelial cell. So obviously it is very thin wall. That's why cancer cells can easily invade. Okay. Lymph vessels are most convenient routes for the spread of cancer cells. Metastasis is the spread of cancer, which can easily occur through lymphatic vessels. So when cancer cells enter the lymph vessels, they are trapped in lymph nodes. If cancer cells escape from lymph nodes, they may pass through lymph vessels to blood circulation, and eventually through blood circulation also cancer cells can spread. Okay, therefore during cancer surgery, so lymph nodes are often removed and their vessels are tied off to prevent spread of cancer. Okay, lymph adenitis. Itis, I already told you, it is inflammation. Angitis is the inflammation of lymphatic vessel, whereas inflammation of lymph node is lymph adenitis. Okay, lymph node is, if it is inflamed, you call it as lymph adenitis. Okay, so we can palpate. Suppose sometimes we also may have throat infection, and you can palpate your neck and you will find some large nodules. You can palpate for yourself. That is actually enlarged lymph nodes. Okay. Sometimes if there is any infection in the upper limb area and thorax region, especially in, if there is any mammary gland tumor also, you will find there is enlargement of axillary group of lymph nodes. Okay, external genitalia infection, there may be enlargement of inguinal group of lymph nodes. Okay, like that, regional wise, whatever area is involved, you will find that particular lymph nodes are enlarged. Okay. So next organ we have, which is concerned with lymphatic system, is spleen, which is the largest lymphoid organ of the body. Spleen, again, we will study in detail when we start abdomen. Spleen, we will also study in histology. This is only general information what we study in general anatomy. So it is present in the left. This area is actually called as left hypochondrium of abdominal cavity, between fundus of the stomach and diaphragm. It looks purple in color, and of course the size varies from person to person. When you see under histology, it will have a capsule and these partitions are trabeculae. Here we have two different types of collections. One is white pulp, where you have same lymphatic nodule like structure of lymph node, and in between you are finding red dots, which is called as red pulp. Okay, so we have white pulp and we also have red pulp. Okay, that's why, because blood is present here, you call it as hemolymph node. So white pulp, it has lymphatic tissue. In the center, you have the central artery. It is same like lymphatic nodule. okay, with or without germinal centers. Okay, this is the red bulb where you have these cords are actually called, we will describe the details of this when we take histology of spleen, don't worry. So these are actually called as cords of Willroth, okay, splenic cords. Here we have lymphocytes, both T and B type of lymphocytes, macrophages and plasma cells. Okay, spaces between these cords are occupied by blood sinusoids. Okay, spleen is covered by connective tissue capsule which sends this trabeculae, these are the partitions. Okay, functions, it filters blood from antigens and microorganisms. It evokes the immunological response against antigens circulating in the blood. It produces B lymphocytes and T lymphocytes. It removes old and dead RBCs, removes bacteria by phagocytosis. It stores blood. It forms blood cells during fetal life. Spleenomegaly is a condition. This is the normal spleen and this is enlarged spleen. So enlarged spleen is nothing but spleenomegaly, usually secondary to other conditions like portal hypertension, malaria, chronic myeloid leukemia and typhoid fever. Okay, then thymus is a structure which is only very well developed only in small children. As we grow older, thymus disappears. It is asymmetrical bilobed gland located in this region which is called as superior mediastinum, behind the sternum bone, manubrium of sternum. It doesn't have any lymph capillaries or lymphatic nodules. Okay, details again we will see in histology structure. It is central lymphoid organ essential for the development of other lymphoid organs. Okay, it is large and well developed in fetus and early childhood. Okay, so structure again you will study in histology, like it has so many thymic lobules. Okay, here peripheral darker area which is called as cortex and central area which is called as medulla. In the medulla area you are finding a rose petal like arrangement of structures which is called as Hassel's corpuscles. Don't worry, we will elaborate this again. Okay, and then these are all thymic lobules. Peripheral area is cortex, central area is medulla. In the medulla area we have thymic Hassel's corpuscles. Okay, so cortex area will have densely packed lymphocytes. Okay, so these are T lymphocytes. Okay, so epitheliocytes help in the maturation of T lymphocytes through thymosin secreted by them. Okay, this is the medulla region. Medulla region is mainly consisting of epitheliocytes and few lymphocytes. Most important feature you have is Hassel's corpuscles. Okay, then enlargement of thymus gland, we will see it is associated with thyrotoxicosis, that is thyroid disorder, Addison's disease, which is related to adrenal gland, myasthenia gravis. Okay, so autoimmune conditions are those in which immune system treats normal body cells or secretions as antigens and destroys them. Okay, these disorders you will study in detail as we proceed, don't worry. Okay, myasthenia gravis is also an autoimmune disease. Okay, so apart from this we have epithelial lymphoid system also, like where we have mucosa associated lymphoid tissue which is seen inside the oral cavity, in the GIT, in the urinary tract, everywhere. Okay, respiratory tract. Okay, gut, this is GIT associated lymphoid tissue, bronchus associated lymphoid tissue we have. Apart from this we have collection of lymphoid tissues in various areas like pharyngeal tonsil, I will show you tubal tonsil, palatine tonsil, lingual tonsil, Peyer's patches and abdominal tonsil. All these details till fourth we will study in head and neck, regional anatomy. Peyer's patches and abdominal tonsil we will study abdomen part of gross anatomy. Okay, to look at, see, this is the area where you have the pharyngeal tonsil. This is actually the the pharyngeal tonsil is wrongly pointed, it is here. In fact, this is actually called as soft palate, and here we have the pharyngeal tonsil, aggregation of lymphoid tissue underneath the mucus lining of the roof of the posterior wall of pharynx we have. Okay, tubal tonsil we will find with aggregation of lymphoid tissue around the posterior margin here. This is the Eustachian tube opening of the middle ear with the nasopharynx. Here also we have lymphoid tissue. Okay, actually here this picture will give us a correct idea. This is the pharyngeal tonsil. Okay, this is the tubal tonsil. This is palatine tonsil. Okay. So, of course, this pharyngeal tonsil is rightly pointed, no problem. Suppose if it is enlarged, you call this condition as adenoid. Okay, this is tubal tonsil with the Eustachian tube. Okay, then palatine tonsil you see in the oral cavity. Most of us also will suffer with these infections. If there is, during winter seasons, they may get enlarged. The condition is tonsillitis. Especially we find such infections in small children. Okay. Behind the tongue, here in this area, we have lingual tonsil, okay? Pears patches, I told you, they are found in the small intestine, okay? That is in the ileum, okay? They are concerned with the killing of microorganisms, all large lymphatic nodules. This is the histological picture and this is the gross picture. When you see in the dissection hall, cut ileum and see interior of ileum looks like this. These round nodules are Peyer's patches. When you see in the histology, when we prepare the slide, this is the mucosal folds lined with simple columnar epithelium. Okay, in the submucosa area and the lamina propria area, you are finding all lymphatic collections. Okay, this will be also elaborated in histology GIT topic. Abdominal tonsil is appendix. Okay, this is histology slide. Here, just you try to emphasize this fact, like in the area, in the wall of the appendix, you are finding lymphatic nodules. Okay, so many lymph nodes, lymphatic nodules you are finding, showing that appendix is not a vestigial organ, but it is concerned with killing of microorganism. Okay, apart from that, we have reticuloendothelial system. Cells of the system are concerned with killing of microorganisms by phagocytosis. Okay, for example, we have macrophages, they are situated in connective tissue, bone marrow, suprarenal gland. Pericytes, we find in capillaries, monocytes in blood. Dust cells, which are alveolar macrophages, found in lungs. Reticular cells, we find in spleen and lymphoid tissue. Kupffer cells, we find in liver. Microglia, these are also killing, doing phagocytic function in the CNS. So that is the extensive topic of lymphatic system. So even if you have found it a little cumbersome, don't worry. Most of the things like spleen, we will have again spleen, thymus, lymph node, all these organs, again we are going to revise in histology. Okay, when we do the histology lymphatic system, we will discuss much in detail. Okay, lymph node is there, spleen, thymus and tonsil. Okay, so I hope you understood the lecture. Okay, these are the reference books which you can study. Okay, Gray's Anatomy is the high level book. You can just go with, first I suggest you to go with simple books, like start from down upwards. Okay, Vishram Singh, then Chaurasia General Anatomy is there. Then you, for reference, you can use Datta and Gray's Anatomy. The standard textbooks are, for General Anatomy, we have Chaurasia and Vishram Singh. Whichever you find easy, you study from that, but don't delay. Immediately after the lecture, if you try to study, you will understand and you will learn the things. Wish you very all the best. I'm stopping here. Thank you.